Thank you very much. I am Prop 8, and I'm very pleased about that. Now, folks, the first thing I want to show you tonight is this little red velvet purse. One of my favorite possessions. I've had it for many years. I got it from a very pretty girl a long time ago. She was she had freckles and little pigtails. She's only about this high. I wasn't much bigger myself. But I won it fair and square. Turns out Go Fish just wasn't her game. She kept her little pennies in this purse. I don't keep pennies in it. I don't think I have a match, but that's a matter because it's not real. I know it would be. It's wood. You can even feel the flame part. Go ahead, it's just wood. Wood and paint. I just keep it because it reminds me of a great pleasure in which I no longer indulge. But I always keep it out of sight, out of mind. I think that's the way. You can check it out.
Oh my God.
Oh my gosh.
I know.
It can be.
And I'll show you. We'll open it up. But that's why I keep it in this thing. I don't know if any of you have ever had experience with the tobacco, but it's a very nasty. It can really be disturbing after a while. You can't take your mind off it. For me, it took over my entire life for a while. But then I got over it. And I discovered what? This little thing. See? Yeah, you need one of these. You put it in here like this, right? And then out of sight, out of mind. And that's it. That's my story. Now, folks, this is these are six silver dollars. These are old silver dollars from the turn of the last century, 1890s to the 1920, that period. These are Morgan silver dollars. You can check them out, look at them. They're real. They're not. You can touch them. They're coins. I'm going to take my rings off because that sometimes confuses things with the clinking. But they're silver coins. The thing is, magic only works with real silver. Well, that's what I tell the IRS, and what I tell my wife. And we have three coins and three coins. Here's what's going to happen. One, two, three coins. You, sir, would you keep up with those? Just watch. We have one, two, three coins. Here, sir, would you keep up with those two? Just watch. Because what's going to happen, I'm going to go like this. When I do, one of these is going to jump over here. I know you weren't ready. But we'll do it again. We'll do it again. All right? We have one. I'll do it again. I don't want you to think I've cheated. We have one, two, one, two, three, four. I go like this, and one of these jumps over here. You want to see how it's done?
Yeah.
I'll show you. I don't care. They don't like it when I do this here at the Magic Castle, but I used to be the vice president of this place. I could do anything. I think it's more amazing when you know. I think it's more amazing when you know. When I take this coin and I place it into this hand, I make a gesture that draws your attention up here in that split second between the coin goes up my sleeve. So across my back, down this sleeve. That's the basic secret. Now that you know how it's done, we'll do it again. Under kind of test conditions. I have three coins in this hand, three coins in this hand. Fair?
Yeah.
Plus, I'm going to put the ring in this hand. Does that confuse you, sir?
What? Okay.
With me? With me?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, folks, if I have. I know. If I go like this, how many in that hand?
Three.
That was good. That was a bluff just to see if you were paying attention.
I think he was.
He obviously was, which leaves how many in this hand?
Three.
Plus?
Three.
Hold my wrist really tight. You hold this wrist really tight. Just say go.
Go.
No.
Huh?
No. No. No.
Yeah, that's a little fun. It's, I'm going to show you, I need a help, an assistance of a couple of guys. This gentleman here, would you help me, sir? And you come over here.
Hi.
I'm Pop, your name is? Cash.
Jake
and Cash. Boy, it's Cowboy City tonight, huh? Jake and Cash. Now, I'm going to show you guys something. Does this, Cash, does this look like a real solid object to you?
Yes.
It is not an illusion, is it?
No.
It's a little pocket knife, am I correct?
Yes.
A pen knife?
Yes.
You know why they call it a pen knife?
No.
Well, in the old days, they used to make pens out of feathers, so they'd have a little knife like this to carve the end of the feather and make a quill pen. They called those pen knives. Thomas Jefferson, our president, invented the first folding pen knife just such as this one.
So cool.
So you see, the act is educational as well as entertaining. Now, when that knife disappears and comes back over here in my pocket, do you know what most people will say?
Cheated.
That's exactly what they say. That wasn't magic. You cheated. Obviously, it went up this sleeve, came across your back, down this sleeve, and into this pocket. Which is exactly what happened. On the other hand, Cash, if you held my wrist and I showed you the knife,
yes,
and you didn't let go and you didn't take your eyes off my hand, and I opened my hand again, that knife was gone. That would not be sleight of hand, would it?
No.
Way. That would be real magic, wouldn't it? Folks, if I show you the knife and you don't take your eyes off my hand and he doesn't let go and I open my hand, that knife is gone, that would be real magic, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would.
Yes. No one can do that. Well, think about it. Cash, the only way that can happen is if the magician first creates what we call the intricate web of distraction. Don't pay any attention at all.
Oh, wow.
What?
See that guy?
Woo!
We're stupid. This is just a distraction, just a distraction. I should explain. See, I have this knife hidden in what we call the palming position, the palming position. From this side, you can see it, but from this side, you cannot.
True.
I like your eyes.
See, it's called palming. It's a principle of magic. As long as you have your hand held in a perfectly natural fashion, no one's ever going to suspect you have a knife hidden on the other side. And then, Josh, when I come over to the black knife, I switch. And then
what?
I switch back. It's a secret to the whole thing.
What?
Well, I'll do it slow so you can follow. We'll put the white knife over here in this hand. Which knife is in this hand?
Black.
What? No, this is the white one. That's the switch, Josh. That's what I'm trying to demonstrate. Pay attention. The white knife over here. The black knife over here. Which knife is in this hand?
Black.
Which knife?
White.
Good guess. Which knife is in this hand?
Black.
White.
I don't know.
Now you catch it. See, that's the switch. That's the switch. Maybe it's confusing you. Cash having two knives out.
Yes.
I'll get rid of one.
Okay.
Just using the black one.
Okay.
Just using the black one. Oh, my wrist really tight. White one will be over here. Don't come anywhere near the black one. You hold my wrist. Which knife is in that hand?
White in this one.
White. And which knife is in this hand? Guess again.
Oh.
Guess again.
White?
Good guess. Huh. But remember what I said about the intricate web of distraction. Guess which knife is in my pocket?
The black one.
You guys have to pay a lot more attention. Thank you. I'll show you. A little game from the 1890s in Skagway, Alaska, during the gold rush in the late 1890s. The whole town of Skagway was taken over by a vicious con man named Soapy Smith. Mm-hmm. And he and his gang of 100 con men came out of the Old West. They had hardened criminals from the silver strikes in Denver and Colorado. They were experts at takedown games like the shell game, three-card Monte. They had fake telegraph offices set up in Skagway. 100 men took over the whole town. It's the only way into the Klondike, the only way out. And most of the people coming through, thousands of people, they were from France and Germany and China and Japan and Mexico. They came from all over the world, from the East. None of them had had any experience out on the frontier. They were called chachacos. They were greenhorns. And most of them never even made it to the gold fields. They got taken for everything they had in Skagway. And a lot of the guys coming back from the gold fields, they had all the gold taken from them in Skagway. So it became a famous thing. And we celebrate Soapy here at the Magic Castle every July with Soapy Smith Night, where we celebrate the great con man, Soapy Smith. But one of the things that they played, a lot of the people that worked for him, the reason he was so famous is because so many people came out of that, Jack London and other people like that, they all knew him and were influenced by Soapy and his gang. Among them, Pantages, Alexander Pantages, was a bartender for Soapy, and he used to steal steaks out of the kitchen. He had leather pockets sewn into his jeans, deep leather pockets, so he could slip a couple of steaks into his pocket on the way home every night. And Soapy caught him and was going to kill him, and he escaped and got across the border into Dawson, where he fell in love with a beautiful girl named Klondike Kate. He parlayed her into a multi-million dollar career in show business, founded the Pantages Theater Chain. Wow. We have one of them here in Los Angeles.
That's so cool.
One of the 22-year-old assayers for Soapy. Now, the assayers were the guys that weighed the gold. One of those guys was named Wilson Misner. And Misner and his brother were well known much later. They, at that time, were just young swindlers, con men. And Wilson became a poet and a playwright and an aphorist, and he wrote a lot of famous lines. You've probably heard some of them. If you steal from one man, that's plagiarism. If you steal from three, that's research. He also said, Hollywood is like a trip through a sewer in a glass-bottom boat. Still true today. Now, folks, one of the things they would do is the assayers would have this shag carpet on the floor, and under the desk they'd have the scales and they'd weigh the gold, and they'd always try and get a little of the gold dust under their fingernails where they could flick it onto that shag carpet, or they would take a little gold nugget out of the pile and accidentally would drop onto that shag carpet. They would do as much of that as they could. After a week or so, they'd burn that carpet. What was left was their take for the week. But there was a lot of downtime, and these are weights. You can check those out. Little brass weights, 2 ounce weights from the period. They're actually a few grains more than 2 ounces, I found out, which I think attests to their authenticity. Now, folks, the idea of the game was this. They would have a lot of downtime waiting for the miners to come up with their gold. So they play this little game. It's amazing and astounding, but stupid. Like cup stacking. You ever seen that game with the plastic cups where they make big pyramid, they take them down? It's really amazing. But pointless and stupid. This is the same thing. The idea of this game was they would just play with the weights, called passing the weights. They would cover them with their hands like this, and one would jump. They'd try and kick it so fast you couldn't even see it move.
What? I would!
No!
Passing the weights.
No.
Passing the weights. I'll do it again. I know you weren't ready.
No.
I know you weren't ready. You're right here, right? Watch closer.
What? Oh my gosh.
What?
Wanna see it one more time?
Yeah.
We'll do it the long way. The long way. This is the longest possible distance. You have to really be accurate or it'll go what you need. Ready?
Yeah. Yes.
Come there to that.
No!
Nope.
What?
That's it.
No!
That's it.
Woo! Yes, sir.
That's passing the weight.
Woo!
Passing the weight. A stupid game from 100 years ago.
Woo!
Now, not all games are stupid. This is a pointless, stupid game, but not all games are. And I'm going to show you one that's not stupid. It has a good point. And so you can make a living off of this game. I grew up in a little town in Tennessee, Clarksville, Tennessee. It's up near the Kentucky border in the middle part of the state. And I was a preacher's kid. And when I was growing up, I was about 8 or 9 years old. This old man moved into our neighborhood right across the street. He was in his 80s. He changed my life forever. He'd been a professional gambler his entire life, was a total reprobate, drank whiskey right straight out of the bottle, chain smoked these little black cigars and cussed like a sailor. So naturally, as a preacher's kid, I gravitated toward his society. And this is one of the things he taught me that stood me in good stead over the years, called the shell game. He uses three little half walnut shells and a little pea. Now, these are not real half walnut shells. When I started out, they were. I ate the walnuts. I carved the shells out. I sanded them down, and I practiced till my fingers were bloody. I got really, really good at this little game. These aren't real. These are fake. These are solid sterling silver. I've been very lucky at this game over the years. I was able to get my nuts cast in silver. But that's not the point. The point is the game has not changed. The game is still the same. All you have to do is keep up with the little P. If you know where the P is, you bet against me. That's all there is to it. This lady right up here, you look like you have a pair of eyes on you. What's your name?
Kelsey.
Hi, Kelsey.
Hello.
Want to play a little game?
Sure.
Oh, good. Oh, good. Where's the pea, Kelsey?
In the middle.
Kelsey, you have eyes like a red-tailed hawk. I think I'm going to have to move the shells around to beat you.
Probably.
You still want to play, though, right?
I do.
You get a lot of complaints, especially from the ladies. Say you started too fast, or I wasn't. I don't want to hear any crap like that.
Okay.
You know where the key is. You know where it is not. Are you ready to play?
Yes.
Oh, the speed, the blinding speed. I lost myself, Kelsey. Oh. They always let you win the first time. Where is it?
The right.
That's a loser. No. Remember the first time she said it was in the middle. That was a winner. This is the second time. No one ever wins the second time. I'll give you a third chance. They don't even do that on the street. I would go here if I was you, Kelsey.
All right, I'll go middle.
You should listen to me, Kelsey. I actually know. So see, you've learned something.
Yeah.
You've learned
I
what?
Caught on.
You've learned what? You've learned that Pop knows where the P is. And you've learned you can trust Pop.
Yep.
Let's play again, see what else we might learn.
Okay.
Ready? Oh, the speed, the blinding speed. I lost myself. Uh-oh.
Oh.
Now I'm confused.
I want to say the one closest to the edge of the table, but...
The middle one.
I think the other one, maybe.
You mean this one?
Yeah, I had a head in the way, but I'm guessing the...
That's a guess? You want to guess that one?
Yes.
Oh. I would have gone for here.
I should have done the middle one.
What?
I should have done the middle one.
I'll go here.
Okay, I'll go there.
See, now you learned something new.
Oh, no!
You learned something new. Kelsey. It's not that you can't trust Pop,
yes,
but you have to know when. This strategy will work with you for most men. Oh, shut up.
Too soon.
Folks, I'll show you why people lose at this game. The reason is the P does not stay under the shell it starts from.
Ooh. No kidding.
You watch between. I wouldn't kid about stuff like this. If you watch between the shelves, you'll see that pee actually move from one shell to another. Could you see that?
Yeah.
It's so obvious. It is so obvious. It's like it's got little legs.
Oh my God.
Like it's got little legs, like a clam. Because that's at half speed. At full speed, you can't see it.
That's true.
I'll do it once at half speed and once at full speed. That way you have something to compare. Ready. Whoa, the speed, the blinding light. Lost myself. Oh, look at that. See, I got some of that. That's the one in full speed. Now, folks, I'll tell you a little bit about the history of this game. We don't know who invented it. Could have been a man. Could have been a woman. We really don't know. The origins have been lost in the mires of time. So I can say just about anything that I want. This game was invented by a man. And his name was Throg. He was a Neanderthal fella, playing with half a coconut shell and a little white smooth river pebble he found on the beach. That was his favorite toy. One day, as he was fooling around the way those Neanderthals were wont to do, he accidentally covered the pebble with that shell. And when he turned back around, it was as if the pebble just disappeared, appeared into thin air. He looked all over and couldn't find it. They didn't know about the persistence of objects. Eventually, he picked up that shell, and there it was. I know it wouldn't be a big deal to me either, but to a Neanderthal, this was like a 2001 moment.
No.
Oh. This kept them occupied all afternoon. It was a simpler time. He took it back to the campfire, showed it to the other Neanderthal men. It became the most popular game of the Neanderthal period, called the one-shell game. Now, as man's cranial capacity continued to evolve, the game lost a bit of its cachet, until some genius Cro-Magnon man came up with the idea of adding two more shells, creating what we would call a three-shell game. They didn't play it the way we do today. They would just move these two around to confuse things. This was before logic had been invented by the Greeks. Before logic was invented, they always bet on one of those two. Why? Because they were the ones that were moving. Before logic was invented, that would have meant something. It would not mean anything to a modern crowd such as yourself. Let's make this as simple as we can. Would you help me, dear?
Okay.
I want you, if you would, just to place that shell on top of the pea. And point it towards you. There we go. Neatness counts. There we go. Yeah. Put a glass on top of this shell. Excellent. Your name is?
Janet.
Janet. Hold your finger out like this, Janet. That's your thumb. Don't feel bad. Everybody falls for that one. You get to pick one of these two, Janet. Which one do you want? You can turn it over if you want, check it, and then turn it back and put a finger on it like that. Okay? So now look at the situation. You know where the P is, you have control of it. You have control of two of the shells. You have 2-to-1 odds, Janet. On the street, this is what they call a lead pipe cinch. On the street, people rip their pockets, taking every dime they've got. They throw it on the table, they look at you, they say stupid, stupid things like pop. I've got you now. But you wouldn't do that, would you?
Well,
of course not. Because why? Because you're an intelligent lady and you know the instant a dime hits this table, what's going to happen?
No.
Check.
No.
It's like a little miracle, I think. It's called the shell game. I am Pape and you guys.
Yeah, in the bigger rooms.